Are you downsizing? Maybe need more room because of additions to the family, or possibly seeking that dream home you've always wanted? Well, Tim Eisner at Royal LePage Atlantic is the guy for you. With a proven track record and multiple awards, Tim goes above and beyond to find out your needs and exactly what you're looking for. So if you're seeking a new home or trying to sell your current one, contact Tim at 902-499-5717 or check him out on Facebook at Tim Eisner. Again, that's 902-499-5717. Trust me, when all is said and done, we'll be saying Tim Eisner strikes again. What is going on, everyone? Hope y'all had an amazing weekend. Welcome to another episode of Outside the Chute. I'm your host, Randy Frame. This week's OTC Player of the Week, and it's our first ever two-time recipient, comes to us from the OC Batbusters Lara team as Sophia Zavarella takes home the honors once again. Sophia hit 800 with three doubles, a home run, six RBIs, five runs scored, and a stolen base last weekend as her and the Batbusters qualified for the Alliance Nationals while competing at the PCFL Winter Qualifiers in Cathedral City, California. Awesome job, Sophia. Keep up the fantastic work. On to this week's guest, and we sat down and chatted with WBSC Men's World Cup bronze medalist and U.S. Men's National Team member, Brad Kilpatrick. Brad has had a fantastic career so far, and he's just getting started. Besides the previously mentioned bronze medal at the 2022 WBSC Men's World Cup, he's also a gold medalist with the Australian Men's Junior National Team that won the 2018 WBSC Junior Men's Worlds here in Prince Albert, Saskatchewan. We're going to talk to Brad about getting a start in the game in his hometown of Sydney, Australia, that junior world title win, what it's like being a part of the University of Florida Gators softball program, and of course, that epic bronze medal win against the defending champion Argentina at the World Cup almost 2 months ago. Brad was an absolute beauty to chat with. Hopey and I can't wait to see what the future holds for him. Pretty sure there's going to be a coaching role down the line. With that being said, grab that drink, sit back, relax, because here we go.
I've got the world in my palm, lights, camera, action, it's on. I can't describe what I'm feeling, ain't never felt this freedom. I've got the world in my palm, lights, camera, action, it's on. Ain't never felt this freedom. Could you say that anything goes, anything goes?
Hey, buddy.
How's it going?
Good, man. How are you?
Not bad at all.
Good, good.
A little bit of crazy weather today for us. But
yeah, it's beautiful out. Jesus Christ.
Oh, the power just
flickered. Wind warnings so. And the rain was torrential. Yeah.
Typical January, end of January.
I guess, yeah. I don't know. It's weird. It's hard to keep any snow on the ground.
Unreal.
Yeah.
Anyway, before we get going, I want to shout out condolences to Randy McNeil and his family. Neely, big part of the sports scene here in Nova Scotia. I mean, I know him from hockey and ball, of course. And
yeah,
he played for the Keys back in the day. Yeah. And hockey was with the Bearcats, TSM Bearcats, when I was with the junior yeah. Bearcats there. And yeah. Big loss, but man, such a positive guy. And the stuff yeah. he went through, like with his cancer and whatnot, but he still remained upbeat and
all the time.
It's such a beauty.
Yeah, Neely was, of course, I grew up playing ball against Neely. I did tell you earlier in 94, he had broken his leg playing against us. I was playing for the Windsor Legion Owens at the time. And that year, the Keys picked me up to go to Nationals. Mm-hmm. So I took Neely's spot at shortstop that year when we happened to win a silver medal. But he was with us the whole trip, and he was like the biggest cheerleader, crazy-ass guy.
Where's the craziest outfits you would...
Craziest outfits, but just so positive, such a nice, great guy. And I've known him and, you know, ever since, and stayed in touch in, you know, certain aspects of, you know, we see him at a hockey game or whatever. Yep. Always positive though. And it's very sad, and condolences to him and his family, of course, and all of his friends. And cause he's touched a lot of people over the years.
Big time, big time. I mean, he was at, there's a lot of pictures going on. Actually, he got on camera at the World Juniors this year, dressed up as the Macho Man, Randy Savage. Yeah. And, but that's just who Neely was. And, man, just it's tough, but at the same time, we're able to look back and smile because he was such an awesome guy.
For sure.
Another thing I want to touch on.
Yeah.
Probably going to catch flack for this, but I don't care.
Fire away, man.
U23 Team Canada.
Yeah.
I'm a little upset.
Yeah, I think a few people are.
The one thing that bothers me, you know, it's not just Bubba not making the team. It's the fact that there's other guys in this province that are getting overlooked.
Didn't even get a sniff.
And look, I'm not saying it. The guys that made it.
Yeah, congratulations
to you guys. But at the same time, it's just, I feel like here in Nova Scotia, we're getting snuffed and it's not fair. I mean, you look at the Canada Games that just happened this past summer.
Yep.
We were amazing. Yep. That team was amazing. David Watson was the best pitcher there.
Best pitcher in Canada at that age group.
Yeah. And it's just very frustrating. Mm-hmm. It really is.
Yeah.
And I don't care if, you know, you guys can message me all you want. I don't freaking care. It's just, it sucks that these guys are getting overlooked.
Yeah.
And that's my point.
I agree 100%. Decisions are made based on whatever they make their decisions on. Mm-hmm. And I can understand that. And it's not easy as a coach to pick teams, of course. I just feel that the process this time, and I know everything got messed up with cancellations and what have you, but it just seemed the process wasn't in place to maybe give those guys a crack to actually break that team, make that squad.
Right.
You know, the Nick Whites, the Brody Fraziers, the Cam Pattons, those guys all were top batters at Canada Games.
Right.
Like top batters in the country.
Yes.
And not even get a sniff.
Yeah. I mean,
David Watson, top pitcher. Said it again.
I mean, we do have the luxury of watching them week in, week out here in our shooters. And I mean, take a guy like Brody, for example.
Yeah.
Like, I watched him hit multiple home runs off Justin Schofield.
Yeah.
And Justin Schofield is one of the best pitchers in the world.
100%.
So, I mean, it is what it is. I mean, hopefully they get their eyes on them.
Yep.
Down the road here, and I'm sure they're going to make a name for themselves. But right now, it's frustrating.
I'll tell you what I'm very sure of: U23 Nationals this summer. When our team Nova Scotia goes, they're going to go there with a chip on their shoulder.
Yep.
And hats off to them.
Yep.
And at the same time, as you said earlier, congratulations to the guys that made it, because you're well deserved for sure.
Definitely.
We're not taking anything away from that. It's just we would have liked our guys to have a crack. That's all.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Another thing.
Yeah.
Winter Classic's going on down in Florida right now.
It sure is.
And, you know, it started today, and today's Thursday, of course, and as we record this. And, I mean, first thing when you walked in here and I said, did you hear Varm do a play-by-play? Because, okay, Varmy, I would listen to you all day do your little spiel on there, because that was entertaining as hell.
The Taco Bell comment really got me.
For Chewy. Yeah, that was good. That was good. And there was a lot of stuff on there. But,
yeah.
Oh, man. But I mean, it's good to watch ball again. And one thing that I found out today was New York Gremlins are going to be doing all their games this summer.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah. And they said it doesn't matter even if they're in... not in the final four in the tournaments.
They're still going to do them.
Still going to do it. Now they'll probably be in the final four in the tournaments. Well,
they should be.
But no, that's good. That's good for everybody to be able to, you know, tune in and watch some high caliber fast pitch for sure.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
Yes. Yeah. And our guest today is down there playing.
He sure is. He played today.
Played today. Oh,
he's playing right now, actually.
Well, no, he just sent me a text. He's we're good for, we're going to be on time.
Oh, good. Yeah. Good, good.
Brad Kilpatrick, of course, bronze medalist with Team USA, pitched a hell of a game in the finals against Argentina.
How about 13 strikeouts?
13 Ks. Great performance. And the other crazy thing, he's an Aussie.
Dual
citizenship. I mean, you know, it's not too often you get guys. Well, I mean, we've seen here guys from Canada getting their, you know, like Musi.
Oh, of course.
You know,
yeah.
But for an Aussie to have their U.S. citizens, you know, you don't see
it's a little different.
It's a little different. So you know, I can't wait to talk to Brad about that. And
it's great for the Americans, that's for sure.
Oh, big time.
Big future for that guy.
Jesus, I mean, and he's young.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, let's
talk about our, Brad. Let's talk about our Yeti draw.
No, let's talk about that after we're done.
Okay, good.
We'll talk about that after we're done.
Just
want to
make some money.
I know. Anyway, let's get to Brad.
Sounds good. Yo.
All right. We're happy to have on with us today WBSC Men's World Cup bronze medalist and current member of the U.S. Men's National Team, Brad Kilpatrick. Brad, thanks so much for coming on the podcast, pal.
Thanks for having me, guys.
How's things going down in Florida today?
Oh, we had a rough start today, but, you know, championships aren't won on Thursdays, so we got plenty of time.
That is true. They aren't won on Thursdays. How did that? Well, I mean... Tough. I got to watch the opener there. I mean, it's always tough to, you know, get back into her in January, though. I mean, especially from a pitching standpoint.
Yeah. I thought, you know, the normal excuse is the hitters need some time to get their swings in and everything like that, but not this week.
That's so true. Oh, man. So what do you guys, you got two done today. What do you got coming up tomorrow? Mm-hmm.
It's a bit of a weird format because I think a team dropped out in our pool. So we have two games tomorrow that don't actually mean anything. And then we have a playoff game at 4 p.m. tomorrow. So, yeah, they had to meet the game requirements. So, yeah.
That's quick.
So you're going right into playoffs.
Yeah, tomorrow against the second team, I think, in the next pool.
Nice. Now, before we get going here, I got to talk about University of Florida. What are you taking there?
Yeah, so pretty much I'm just a student manager with the team there at the University of Florida. So get to study and be around the team and, you know, enhance my skills and hopefully one day coach. But yeah,
that's it's fantastic. An
awesome experience, awesome school.
Wow.
That's awesome. That would, that'd be like a dream.
Just another Aussie taking some American's job.
Yeah, that's it.
Right. Oh, so that's fantastic.
How's the season looking for you guys? I mean, obviously you guys are ranked fifth in the preseason ranking. So, I mean, that bodes pretty well.
Yeah. So everything's kind of coming together now and we're having a lot of inner squad games and things like that. But, yeah, look, the pitching's there, the hitting's there, the fielding's there. Just we're pretty much itching for it to start now.
Yeah, no doubt. Now, I mean, you've had a lot of great coaches coming up. What's it like being under Timmy Walton there?
Yeah, he actually reminds me of one of my coaches back at home. You know, he's strict but fair and is very much a winner, if that makes sense. He just loves winning, loves doing things the right way, and he pays attention to detail. If something's out of line, he makes sure it's fixed before he hits the next ground ball.
That's where you're going to be though. I mean, yeah. Frank.
Yep.
You got a, what the pitching staff there, Hightower is still there, correct?
Yeah, they have Hightower. They have, Riley Trilicek, is a lefty, a senior. They have a sophomore, Lexi Delbray. They have a transfer from Tennessee, Sam Bender as well. So
right on. Excellent. So what's campus life like?
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. We're having a lot of fun.
no doubt. That's
they awesome. Make sure that they make sure that they say you're a student manager, not a manager student.
For sure. All right, we're gonna do quick pitches. We haven't done this with any of the guy guests in a long time. We're gonna dust off quick pitches and we're gonna throw some questions at you. We're gonna throw some questions at you.
Okay.
All right. First one. I ask it with all my guests. If you had to live off one food for a week, what is it?
Ooh, a week. Oh, it has to be pizza. Yeah, that's, has to be a good pepperoni pizza.
Yeah, that's you know what? That's a common answer on here. Like,
yeah. I think it'd be common for any sport person, anybody in the world.
Yeah,
100%.
True.
Yeah,
it's a staple.
Best thing about University of Florida.
It does have to be the sport, like the sporting, especially the football games. A couple of the football games I went to last semester had 90,000 people, and that was my introduction to college sports.
So, yeah, holy shit.
Yeah, that's crazy.
That'd be amazing.
Yeah.
That'd be amazing.
Yeah. I didn't realize, especially coming from Australia, we don't really have much. It's more sports on one side, school on another. And over here, just seeing them put it together, it's unreal.
That's crazy.
Oh, that's right too. Yeah. That's right too. I never even thought of that.
Yeah.
If you could go back and play one game over again, what one is it?
In a good way or a bad way?
Either way, whichever.
Yourself.
Yeah, I think the bronze medal game in the Pan Americans, I'd like to have back.
In the Pan Ams, yeah.
And, yeah, in the Pan Ams. And then I'd like to have that back just to try and win that game. But then if I wanted a good game, it'd be the bronze in the World Championships. That's probably the best one.
Yeah, we'll talk about those.
100% we will.
Maybe. toughest hitter you've had to face? I'm sure there's a few.
Yeah, it has to be Zenon Winters. He owns me. Put me out twice today. Thank you for that on Australia Day. Thank you, mate.
That's amazing. Past guest of the show too. Actually, what's funny, you wouldn't have got to hear this at all, but we were talking about this before we started, is on the main diamond there when Hill were playing the Bombers, Varm Matiosian was doing the play-by-play. And oh my God, it was probably the funniest stuff I've ever heard. And he was talking about, he said Zenon was leaving the ball field, and he's like, the place just got so much better because Zenon left the ball for it. Like, just stuff like that. Oh, man.
Oh, a lot of pitches were breathing a sigh of relief.
Oh, man, that's awesome. Next one here. Where am I at? Best thing about growing up in Australia?
Yeah, it has to be the fact that we can play all sports all year round. Sorry to rub it in, but yeah. but yeah, definitely the weather and the ability to do anything. And we have winter competitions and everything. So yeah.
So when it is winter there, what's the lowest it gets down to?
Well, I'm from Sydney, so it'd be very rare overnight for it to get below zero. Like if we have an early morning, it'll probably be single digits. But if it gets like midday, it'll probably get around 10, 11 at the very cold.
Nice. Oh,
man. That's like perfect weather. Mm-hmm. Man, that's awesome.
Yeah. That's really nice.
Go-to show to binge watch?
Ooh, that's a good one. Lately, I've been watching Manifest.
Great show.
I've been watching that.
Great show.
And then I also am a reality guy, so I do love my little Love Island and my things like that. I might cop a little bit of stick for that, but I'll say it.
I might clip that out and post that on social media.
That's a little guilty pleasure for you guys.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's all good. It's all good. Two more here. Best live sport and event you've attended?
I went to... There's a few. I mean, one of them would be going to the football games. But I went to the first ever game at SoFi Stadium that fans were allowed in. So after COVID,
oh wow,
I got to check out that new stadium in Los Angeles. The Rams played the Bears, and
wow,
that was an unreal experience.
Oh freak, that would be amazing. Wow.
Yeah. I didn't even know at the time. I was just stuck over in the States because of COVID, and then I was having myself in LA, got a ticket, and boom, there.
Oh. Jeez, that worked out then.
Yeah.
Last one here. Now you got to answer this one. Like you have to be dead on this.
Honest.
One. Out of the two, who's the better player? You or Narissa?
Oh, it depends. She has a way better swing than me, but I don't know if she can throw a rise ball.
That was a loaded question. I had to end it with that one. Those who don't know, of course, Narissa, your girlfriend, is with the New Zealand women's national team, correct?
Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
It's pretty crazy.
That's a good combo there.
Absolutely.
Yeah, she she's very, very talented outfielder. So,
right on.
She doesn't like it when I'm throwing batting practice to her though, at all.
That's awesome.
We get a bit too competitive.
Oh, well, that's all right. It's good to have that though.
As long as your curveball's working.
Yeah, as long as that curveball's working.
Until it hits her in the thigh.
Yeah.
All right, man. So let's get into your career. As with every guest on here, tell us how you got your start in the game.
Yeah. So, I was 4 years old, and then my dad's from America over here in Florida, and he was living in Australia at the time and didn't want me playing cricket. So he went to sign me up to kind of like the baseball, like little field area there. And then we had some family friends who were actually, their older sister played softball. And instead of going the baseball route at the sign-ins, he just went over to the softball side, and they went over to the softball side and signed me up for softball. And I played T-ball all up. And then basically it was to make the move eventually to cricket or to baseball or something like that. But I just had too many friends and stuck with it, and then found out about our junior pathways and figured it out from there.
Right on. Right on. So love for it right away, or did it, like, was that something that, you know, grew over time?
I think it was love right away, I'd say, because it was a toss up between that and rugby league, rugby over in Australia. And I just kept getting hurt. So I was like, all right, softball's a sport.
Yeah. A little bit more forgiving.
A little bit.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's one thing, like, I'm sure a lot of our listeners, because we've had past Aussies and Kiwis on, but I mean, like, from your perspective, what exactly, like, cricket and rugby over there is massive, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And yeah, I mean, so huge. I mean, that'd be compared to football in America and hockey up here in Canada.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. So, I mean, for you down there in Australia to, you know, to stick to softball, I mean, were any of your friends like, what are you doing? You know, come play this game.
It was strange that, like, kind of by the time I got to 12, 13 years old, they'd kind of outgrown the sport, or a lot of times it's like T-ball, like everyone plays a little T-ball, and then just to get their hand-eye coordination as a kid, and then they kind of find their other sport that they play in the winter. So if it's basketball or rugby or soccer, and then they kind of take over that when they're in their teens and kind of leave softball. But I don't know, I just kind of, I did love pitching, and I think that the fact that as a kid I'd play in the outfield and I'd also hit a little, that's not mentioned much anymore. But I just loved pitching. And then I honestly didn't even know about where the sport could take me until I just met more and more people. And then,
So did you get into pitching right away? Like, of course not in T-ball, but I mean, as soon as, like, at an early age, was it?
Yeah, probably around 11 years old. We had a pitcher, and then they got hurt. And then I was actually playing shortstop, and then I came in to pitch, and we ended up winning the game. And then our pitcher was out the rest of the season, and we ended up winning. And then, I just kept pitching from there. And that was it.
Now, the coach was probably like, oh, we got a lefty. Like,
yeah, exactly.
Here we go.
Yeah. I think that's the only reason I got put in.
Yeah. Like, good coaching maneuver right there.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, I mean, was there, like, from those early years playing, you know, up until you, you know, started taking serious, any good memories from those early years?
Yeah, I think we had, because our system's very, it's very step by step. So like we played at our local association, and then we made our association team, which was a rep team. So you compete then at the state championship. So I think every weekend I'd play for Georges River, which is my local area. And then I just remember one day getting a letter in the mail, and it said you'd made the New South Wales, like our state team. And I didn't even know that really existed. And then we got to play at the national championships. And then obviously the phone call when I made my junior team, that was pretty surreal. But that was when I kind of realized,
hey, are the nationals going on right now in Australia? Men's nationals?
Yes, they are.
Yeah. That's where David Watson's pitching right now.
Oh,
from Canada.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Right on. Yeah. Oh yeah. Cause it's summer there. Jeez. Of course. Yeah. Anyway, you just mentioned the junior team there, junior national team. That's a good segue in, cause I was going to ask, you know, around what age was it that you started taking it a bit more serious and thoughts of the junior national team, you know, started becoming more realistic?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I was pretty naive going into it and didn't really understand that it was like outside of my local area that softball was played. Mm. So I kind of just went along and just went about things. And then I think we had these things called friendship series where they'd make two junior teams, I think at under 16s or under 17s, and then a New Zealand team would come over, and then we'd play a lot of other local guys. And I think
then we sat in a room one, like our very first night, and they talked about what representing Australia in the green and gold. And I think one of the past players brought in their gold medal from 2009. And that's when it kind of really sunk in that you could represent, like, the meaning of representing your country and your nation and things like that. So yeah, it was probably when I made the friendship series, I think I was 15, that mm-hmm. I really tried to push for it.
Now, would you have known, like, at that age, did you know about, like, Adam and Cheese and Shelsey and guys like that?
Yeah, there was, like, it was more just, like, talk around. So, like, my area was more James Todhunter, Hayden Matthews, and Harry Peters.
Oh, okay.
Were our guys. And yeah. then I never watched above until I started playing with them, probably 16, 17, and then started watching softball and following softball.
Yep.
That's when I was like, oh wow, we have some people here that are unreal.
Crazy talent.
They're okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So was it 2017? Is that when you were named to the Aussie Junior National Team?
Yeah. So we played in Prince Albert 2018.
Yeah. So yep. How special was that for you?
That was surreal, because we actually got told that there was one certain day that they were making the phone calls, and I was actually boarding a plane to Thailand that day, and I was just hoping that I had service on my phone. And I was at the gate and got the call, and I honestly was so happy. That was wow. Probably one of the biggest moments of my life, for sure.
No, two big wows. You're getting on a plane to go to Thailand and you get the phone call.
Yeah. Oh, I made the trip so much better.
Oh, imagine.
flight probably felt a little shorter.
Yeah, for sure.
So let's talk about that 2018 WBSC Junior Men's World. And it was actually here in mm-hmm. Prince Albert, Canada. Of course, you guys captured gold. How awesome was that moment for you?
Yeah, that was unreal. It was cool, because I was a little bit more of like a fringe. Like, I didn't know if I was going to make it. I was came on as the third or fourth pitcher, and just to get the opportunity just to even travel overseas for softball was a really big thing for me. And then to win gold and have our boys, like, our sticks are on fire. Leighton Reed and Sean Lennigan were on fire that tournament. And
Leighton Reed was okay.
They really tore up. Yeah. They just tore up. I made my job so easy.
Just going to throw a few innings here and there. What I think.
Yeah, here and there, and give them a rest. And
yeah. Leighton threw a no-hitter against Japan in the finals, did he not?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep, he did.
Like, I mean, it's one thing to throw a no-hitter, but I mean, against
the
Japan.
Of the world. Yeah.
Jeez.
Crazy.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Man,
it was unreal.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Now, 2019, you get to play your first ISCs with the team you're currently with, Ostrander Norseman. I yep. love that name. That's such a good name too. how did that all come about?
So it was the end after the 2018, I kind of started looking into the men's pathway and realizing that it goes beyond juniors. And at the world championships, you know, obviously I have the dual citizenship with the US, so we went up to the US people. I can't remember who it was, but we got in touch with Bob Pittock, who I think was actually coaching one of the teams at the time, the junior team, and he got me over in San Francisco in the end of 2018, and I played a weekend tournament in California. And then after that, I just said, if you have anyone who wants a pitcher to come over and play. And he got me in touch with Brett Legler here. And then, yeah, it's been fun ever since.
It's amazing.
That's crazy.
Opportunity.
Yeah. Wow.
Like, the connections within our softball world are
yeah,
it's pretty sick. Crazy. It's awesome.
Yep, definitely.
Yeah. What was your impression of that first ISCs? I mean, was it a big eye opener for you?
Yeah, huge. Cause we, I was going in with the full expectation of just watching, and then I had to eat a couple of innings towards the end against Nith River, I think it was, and we had a close game there, and then I made sure that I was staying the rest of the week. It was the best softball I've ever seen.
Oh, you stayed and watched?
Stayed and watched. I watched the final. I think it was the Cubs then, Kitchener Cubs and the Gremlins at Circle Tap.
Wow. Oh, right. That's when...
just watching Cheese and Marta go at it.
Yeah, the Cubs insane. Made a run. They made that run with only 12 guys on the bench there. Because we had yep. Quentin Brute.
Yeah, that was...
Yeah, Brucey, yeah.
Yeah, Brucey was on. Yeah. Yeah, that was a crazy ISCs. Anyway, great place to have your first one, Circle Tap, too.
yeah, that was great. I was like, wow, we should do this
more. Okay, wait. Do you have any good stories from the bar there or what?
Not for the podcast.
Oh, that's awesome. Oh, great. So how did your COVID shutdown look like? I mean, my question I have here is, were you in the U.S. or Australia? Obviously, you were in the U.S. because you said you got the... go to that football game after. So
yeah,
how did that work for you?
Yeah, so 2020 I was spent in Australia the whole year. We couldn't get over, so Australia had the 2 weeks quarantine for the border, and then I think the state I was in, it was either like 100 or 200 people a day from all international countries could only get into the country. So when 2021 hit, I realized I could actually get out of Australia on my US passport. And they weren't letting people leave Australia, because then obviously it would restrict people coming back in.
Right.
So I actually left on my US passport, and then when it was time to come home, I was Australian.
Man, you lucked out.
So I did. So I got over for the 2021 season when a lot of people couldn't get in. And, but yeah, it was just a mess with all the flights and the law changes and, things like that. So I got stuck for, they originally told me, it was the day after ISC, they said I wouldn't be able to get home till Christmas, but someone got COVID somewhere and I got a plane ticket. They just said, wait in LA. And I was like, okay, I will.
Jesus.
That's crazy. That's insane.
Yeah. It was a mess.
So that first, like, I guess it would be summer here, 2020. It would have been winter in Australia. Were you able to keep active, like doing anything down there? Or?
No, we weren't allowed to do anything. We couldn't, we had to like scan QR codes just to go to the shops, and they weren't, like all the shops and the pubs and everything was closed. There was no softball. There was nothing really. We kind of just chilled out.
Wow.
That seems like such a long time ago now.
It does.
And it really wasn't.
Yeah.
What a shit show, man.
I know. It was crazy.
Yeah. It was a mess. I was just really, really blessed to get over here in 2021.
Yeah,
for sure. If you're into online sports betting, well, we have the app for you. I'm telling you right now, I use it personally, and it's helped me cash out at the highest odds possible a few times now. You see, betting lines have different odds at each sportsbook. By using the BetStamp app, you can line shop across all sportsbooks to ensure you are finding the best value available for each wager. It's like using Trivago to find the best deals possible, essentially. I'm sure everyone has used Trivago at one point in their lives. Well, by using BetStamp, that's exactly what you're doing in the sports betting world, by trying to find the best payback for your buck. I'm telling you right now, this app is awesome. Go download it today and use the referral code OTC. Well, what are you waiting for? Do it now. Again, that code is OTC. Now, I mean, you touched on a little bit about joining the U.S. men's national. Okay, here's my question. How did joining the U.S. men's national team come about? I mean, you kind of touched on a little bit.
Yeah, it was always like a thought in my head, because to be honest, like I thought like, oh, we've got Cheese, Folkard, we've got all these guys ahead that, you know, if I'm going to be one of them fringe players for this Steelers team, like I might as well see what's out there and see if I can get a go on the US team, because, you know, see what I can do. And then, yeah, I got over with it was like a USA Futures team in 2018 at the end in November. And after that, I came over here for ISC, and at the time Greg Leather was the coach, and he always just said, you know, just stick around and you can be there one day and we'll see what happens. Cause at that point, you know, the world was getting pushed around and
right. No
one really knew when we were going to be playing. So really I spoke to then it transitioned to Ron Hackett being the head coach, and I spoke to Ron nearly every week, and he just said like, look, this is the opportunity that you have. This is, you can come over and play. He got me in the 2021 season with the Ashland A's. He hooked me up there.
Okay.
And I played that season with the Ashland A's and kind of was a bit closer to just the US guys playing a bit more tournaments in his area. And then after that, I didn't really know, but I had to kind of make a decision, like if I'm up for selection, and it was the selection year coming up, I had to make a decision, and I basically just said, what do I want at the end of the day? And I said, I want to coach softball for a career, and that's in the US, and I'll be playing all my softball in the US. And it just made sense to just commit over here, and yeah, and they gave me a really good opportunity to get game time. Plus, they also play a lot more. Like, well, at the time, yeah, it was qualifiers. So,
right.
So yeah, that was another thing.
That's true, too. So, for you personally, as an Aussie, what's it mean for you to wear the red, white, and blue?
Yeah, so it's weird because I didn't grow up. Like, I don't think I have that same feeling for the, as I do with the green and gold. But whenever you're representing a heritage and a place that your family and people come from, and a place that I now call home, it means something to, especially when I found out that there wasn't a medal in 22 years and that I'm 22 years old, I was like, I want to be the first one to bring this back. Like, I want to be there for when this happens.
That's sick, man. That's so awesome.
I love shit like that.
Yeah. Yeah. We're both crying right now.
Yeah. Cut the clean. That's awesome. That's awesome. And you know what? You know what's funny? I mean, you touched on, you know, the fact that you looked and you saw Cheese, you saw Adam. What's even crazier is the fact that, you know, then Australia has Marshall Kronk comes out of nowhere and can pitch and hit like a stud. And this little 18-year-old Jack Besgrove is pretty good too.
I don't know, little is the word to use.
Oh yeah. He's gonna dominate the game for a long time. But the thing with Marshall is he's been pitching at home for a long time. I just don't think it was recognized.
No, it definitely wasn't. It definitely wasn't. And you know, the combination that he has, like, I'd put him right now top five players in the world. Like 100%.
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. I think you got the WBSC MVP and then the ISC MVP.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
That's okay. That's okay. I mean, that's a good year.
Yeah, that's pretty good. I know I don't want him in the box when I'm pitching.
No. Now, obviously, we're going to talk about the WBSCs, but I want to ask about the Pan Am qualifiers down in Argentina. I mean, you talked about that bronze medal game. How cool was it playing in that environment?
It was scary. It was cool and scary at the same time. I think it was kind of like a holy shit, you've made it moment with a side of, all right, now don't stuff it up.
Yeah.
It was when we got the schedule, I think a couple months before, and we saw like 8 p.m. first night against Argentina, we were like, oh, okay. This is gonna be a big one. I think they said 12,500 people at that game.
That's insane.
It was crazy.
That's so great.
Well, I mean, we watched it.
It was like a soccer atmosphere with drums and flares.
Yes.
And we were blessed because Marta was throwing absolute gas. I think he struck out 8 of the first 9 and then it rained. And we couldn't be more thankful for that rain.
Thank you, rain. that's crazy. That's crazy. And you know what? That's one thing I would like to see. Like, of course, we have the WBSCs coming here in 2025.
Yeah.
I would love to see Argentina host one because that would just be a party atmosphere the entire time.
Yeah, it was the most fun ever. You kind of felt like a little celebrity there. It's like, you know, people yelling at you in the outfield and signing autographs, taking photos. Like, we had to get kind of escorted out to our buses just because there was lines of people trying to get to you.
Yeah.
And it was unreal.
Now let's talk about the WBSCs World Cup, because I mean, man, that was quite a show. I mean, we've talked about it on here. You know, the product that they put on, you know, for everybody to see across the world was awesome. For you personally being there, you know, of course, win the bronze was awesome. But I mean, before that bronze medal game and everything, talk about going there and the lead up and playing, like, how awesome was it?
Yeah, it was awesome. We the day we got there it's funny because New Zealand's very similar to Australia, so it was almost like coming home without coming home,
right?
And then when we got there and we had a practice session, and they actually had all of our warm-ups game out on a turf diamond out the back, and we were like, okay, like a turf diamond, that's fine. And pitching off that's a lot different to pitching off dirt. But then I think the day before the tournament, we got to go in and have a practice on the field and have a look at the stands and the cameras that they had around, and even just looking at all the flags and like the signage, you're like, wow, like, it's not even the fact that you're there. It's just people go to so much effort to make this. And you kind of think of all your volunteers back. You just think about all that stuff that growing up, that the little lady at the canteen who made sure you had waters and things like that. And it's like, now you're at the world's biggest stage. So
yeah, that's like, yeah. You know what? It's funny you brought that up. That's one thing that I don't think is brought up enough is volunteers.
No,
at these big events, like, this is what makes these things work. And, you know, we have an event here that unfortunately we're probably losing this year's Tie Fest.
Right.
It's because of volunteers, right?
Yeah. We're losing it because of volunteers.
We're losing it because we can't get volunteers.
Yeah.
And it sucks. And for all those people, like, this is just me personally saying it, for all those people that go out and volunteer for big events like this,
yeah,
hats off to you.
Thank you.
Because it's what makes them work. That's just my spiel. That came out of left field. Sorry, Brad.
It's okay, Randy.
No, it's true. We wouldn't have got that. We wouldn't have got, especially all the Aussie guys. It's all volunteer. No one's getting paid.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So let's talk about the tournament. I mean, you guys, the games were so close. Like, all the games were awesome. You know, for you guys, going into it, of course, the mindset was medal. And we talked to Ron Hackett prior to it, and he said medal. For you guys, I'm sure the message was the same thing. Like, what was your mindset going in?
Yeah, I had more of the mindset of, like, I mean, I know, I'm very self-aware when it comes to softball and things like that. And I know that everything and everything said about the team is very much, well, they've got a great lineup, a great field, but how's the pitching going to go? And it's how's the pitching is like, no one thinks the pitching's up to scratch. And it was more of a, like, what do you have to lose? There was really, like, if we keep us in every game, and that's our job. And we, as a pitching committee, all four of us, we kind of knew that it was going to come down to all of us. It was going to be a very different game plan and strategy to get us to the end of the week. And we just said, if we just get our 6 to 9 outs, 12 outs, then we're going to be in every game. And that's what happened.
Yeah. Were you listening to our preview show by chance? Sorry.
I think I did. I think I listened to it the night before we played. I said, hey, this is brilliant. This is just what I need.
Freaking right. We motivated you.
There you go.
There you go. So, I mean,
couldn't have done it without you.
Yeah. Hey, we do what we can. That bronze medal game against Argentina, of course, you know, going into the bronze medal game, you're playing the defending champions and you're getting the ball. What was your mindset going into that final game?
Oh, honestly, it's cheesy, but I'm pretty sure Palazzo and Mullins said, let's shock the world before we got on the team bus. And I was like, oh, yeah, I mean,
that's sick.
Let's yeah. do it. Sure.
That's amazing.
like they were like, hey, like, we're here. We played to, our goal was to play on Sunday and we did it. So,
yeah.
But we still had to win. It's not like we're in the gold where if we lose, we get a medal. Like, we had to earn it. So.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah.
Earn it, you did. 13 Ks and you shut out the defending champions, man. I mean, hats off to you. I mean, that was a hell of a performance.
Yeah, that was amazing. The curveball was working.
Yeah, we were pretty lucky. They came off a really, really tough game the night before. I think that that helped us a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For sure.
Here's a sidebar question. What's your thoughts on the whole format for the WBSCs? Because, I mean, you talk about that game before. I mean, that could have went sideways pretty quick. You know what I mean? Like, if Argentina had a score to run, you know what I mean? Like,
well, it was messed up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That, I think I share most opinion where the format isn't suitable for softball, I would say. And, but in saying that, we had four losses and ended up in a bronze medal game to a team that lost by one run from a gold medal game. Like, biasly, perfect format. If it was before the tournament, it's a mess.
Yeah, if you were saying that before the tournament, you were like, oh, this is how it's going to work. Everybody would be like, no, that's not right. But now you're like, oh, it's exactly perfect. Right. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, we snuck in because it's a little bit too much of just relying on other factors that aren't yourself.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, when you guys won, good team celebration?
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. we had a bar kind of just to ourselves. It was a great team thing. Like, we really made sure that we stuck together, and we had a few drinks and some food, and then
And the thing is, you know, usually after an event like that, everybody's dead. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you know, you have your few drinks and your body just starts shutting down on you, right?
Yeah, because that was a lot of ball in a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
Yeah,
it was so crazy because during the whole thing, I even forgot, like, I walked into the bar and I forgot to actually take my playing uniform off. So I all the photos of that night, I have my jersey inside out. Because I couldn't drink in my uniform.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, Frank, that's awesome. That is so awesome.
That's how you celebrate.
Yeah, freaking right. So what's the future hold for you? What's going down the line here, you know, from a playing standpoint and, you know, what you want to do off the field?
So pretty much stick with Ostrander this RSC and try and – I think we have a really good young team forming here. I think that Ostrander for some people might not be a team that people can really, really say is going to win big games. But I really do think that that this year we can do some special things. We had people last year just take leaps and bounds, and we only got better. So I think we got something really, really special brewing. And then pretty much on call. I'm not sure if there's like another qualifier this year for the USA team, but I know there will be one. Will be one next year. So
yeah, I don't think there's one this year. I think there's one in 24. Americas. Yeah.
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 Yeah. So yeah, that'll be really fun. And then got to earn everything back and prove that it wasn't a fluke. And then pretty much I'm gonna finish my degree. So I've got 2 years left of my sports management degree at Florida, and then I'm looking into getting coaching. So
it's fantastic.
That's wicked. And you got to get Timmy Walton on this podcast, by the way.
Have you tried?
Oh yeah.
No, I haven't tried.
I'll try. I'll do my best. Yeah. I'll shoot him a text.
Yes. I'd love to talk to that guy. What was my, I had a question. I had a follow-up question, Hopi, and I lost it.
You're hammered.
Yeah, hammered. Anyway, that was it about the ISCs this year. Like, this is one of those ISCs where, you know, last year we talked about, you know, there's not just Hill United and the New York Gremlins. Now, this, like, the past ISC season, there was three or four teams that stepped up and were like, I think this season we're going to be back to like 10 to 12 where
I hope so,
you know, where anybody can win. And I think with you pitching with Ostrander, I think you guys are one of those teams.
Yeah, I really hope so. I think it just makes it so much fun. Like, I know when I was playing nationals in Australia and everything like that, everyone was just Chiefs Gremlins are in it every year. And then ever since I've gotten over here, there's just been, with the rise of more international, especially the South American and Americas, has just gotten so much more equal. And then you add in the Australians and the Kiwis, and there's just too many players for two teams. So,
The Czechs and actually, who was the, there's a pitcher for Cuba there. Who was the pitcher for Cuba in WBSC?
Romain?
Yeah. Who's he with? Is he with anybody?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure if they can get into the US.
Yeah. I don't know either.
Oh,
yeah.
Good point. Man, he'd be a solid pickup for anybody.
Yeah.
He threw, I think, 50,000 pitches that 1 week.
Oh, 100%.
He was unbelievable. Yeah. It's like, I couldn't believe it. My shoulder was hurting watching him.
I was like, do they have another pitcher? Like, legit, do they have another pitcher?
No.
So we have of course, we end every podcast with the Player Association. I'm going to throw some names to you. And if you have a story, Let It Fly, or Just Talk About Them? Got her?
Okay.
First one, Riley James.
Riley James. Oh, me and Riley, we go way back. Riley's like my little brother, even though he plays for the wrong team. But he is going to be a guy that he's going to be, I dare compare him to some of the best Australian hitters already as a young one. He's going to, he's a guy who every nationals, we played every year against each other. We were similar ages and you can't strike him out. And we'd have 20 pitch at bats, 15 pitch at bats. And it's just like, oh my God. And he just waits for his pitch and he crunches it.
That's all right. I have a lot of guys that
he's going to be a staple.
Nice. Next up, Callum Bachel.
Callum is the happiest, most go-lucky guy in the world. I think we've roomed together most of my nationals, and yeah, he's the best. Love him.
Nice. Blaine Milheim.
Oh, I hate that guy. No, Blaine's a little pest. He's good.
he had a fantastic WBSC.
He sure did.
Yeah, I think he's probably, in biased opinion, the best player in the world. But he's a freak. I like love him. He every inning in Argentina, or every time there was a throw around, he would just stare me right in the eyes coming back from third base and slap me in the leg. And he's like, "You got that dog in you."
That's awesome.
And not even gonna lie, that gets me going. I was like, "All right, that's, let's go."
Oh, 100%, man. I'd be losing my mind. Yeah. I'd be like, "Let's go."
For a quote unquote outfielder to be playing third base in men's fast pitch is insane, and to be hitting the ball the way he does is unreal.
Oh, he's an outfielder? I never knew that, actually.
He hits.
He does hit.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Friend of the show, Yusuf Davis Jr.
Yusuf. Yusuf is the... He's like a little bunny rabbit, isn't he?
I guess he is.
Yeah. He's so much. He is. To be honest, with Yusuf, I think I was... It's just kind of weird because he's older than me, more experienced than me, done everything to me, but I've never been more proud of a person than when he hit the home run in the bronze medal game.
I was going
to
bring that up.
I've never been like so happy for someone in my life, because he does his homework and he really loves, breathes softball. Like, he has videos on every pitcher, knows what's coming. And I think the best part about our WBSC was there was every game, it was someone different.
Yeah.
Yep.
And he chose the bright lights to hit a home. I'm pretty sure I told him this, and I meant no offense, but I said, "I don't think I've ever seen you hit a home run." And that was massive.
And
your face, Brad.
And against the best pitcher in the world.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like that.
Yeah.
Like, man, when he hit it, I was like, mm-hmm. Whoa. He just hit a home run off Matta in a bronze medal game. Like, yeah. I was the same way. That's awesome.
I was so excited, went out, high-fived him, and then I was like, okay, now it's my game to
lose. Now I got to pitch. Shit.
Yeah. Oh, freak. Oh, that's awesome. Last but not least, your catcher, Nicky Mullins.
Yep, he is the whole reason that I think I have been able to mature as a pitcher. I think the best part about him is I've never had to question anything. I never had to question that we didn't know the hitters. I thought he's seen everyone more than
probably.
I've even thrown pitches, and I don't think I've shaken him off ever.
Well, I mean, a catcher that, you know, what he's been through. I mean, why would you?
Warrior.
Yeah. So now it's trying to make sure that he's there for next cycle and in the cycle after that. He needs to stay. I love Nick. I think you saw, because on when we finally won, instead of just jumping up in the air, I jumped and wrapped my legs around.
I guess you did.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Poor Nicky. Nicky's like, "Holy Jesus, Brad. What are you
What are you doing?"
That's all. Hey, man. Hey, big moment for you. And listen, man, we got to thank you for coming on here. I mean, took the time. You're in the middle of a ball tournament down in Florida, and taking your time to come on and talk to us about your career and everything going on. We really appreciate it.
Yeah, no, thank you guys. No, I'm a big fan of the show. Love what you guys are doing. So anytime.
Awesome.
Best of luck in Florida. Best of luck in school. Best of luck with your coaching career. Look forward to watching you play all summer. Should be a fun summer for everyone. I'm actually watching Nick Shales at bat right now.
Yeah.
The Florida
beautiful.
Tournament. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
All right, Brad. Thanks again, pal. Take care.
All right. Thanks, guys.
See you, pal. Right. Take care.
See you later. Good stuff, man.
Yeah. Really good stuff. Yeah. Bright future.
I didn't know you were watching the game.
Yeah.
Who's playing?
I just haven't. Hill's playing whoever the other team is.
Oh.
And Nick just hit a 2-run single.
Oh, good. Good talk.
Yeah.
Chelsea's okay.
He's not bad.
Anyway, yeah. Great chat with Brad. I mean, another up and comer.
Yeah. Bright future. Like he has aspirations of becoming a coach.
And I love that.
NCAA, yeah. I mean, that's sick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Especially, and he's with the perfect program down there.
100%.
Like one of the most nationally renowned programs in the States for women's fast pitch.
Yep.
And, you know, he has Timmy Walton to, you know,
mentor him.
Yeah. And that's huge. That's so awesome. I'm like, I can't wait to see what he does.
It's amazing the networking that takes place. Like just to know somebody, to talk to somebody, to get somebody. Yeah. Do you want to come to San Francisco, play in a tournament?
Yeah,
sure. Like, holy, the opportunities are out there.
Yeah.
God, it's amazing.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah. Very proud moment of them winning a bronze medal. You know, we're Canadian and we wear our heart in our sleeve or our leaf on our sleeve, I guess. But I was super proud that Americans won the bronze medal game.
And I mean, we have connection with
guys on the team
with Yusuf and you know,
Cam, everyone,
and
yes.
Yeah. Maddie, those guys. Yeah. I mean, it was fun to watch. Yeah.
Good one. Yeah.
Good one. Anyway, we have a draw.
Yeah, we have a Yeti draw coming up to help us get to beautiful British Columbia.
Yes, BC.
Yeah, you'll see it posted on our Facebook page, social media pages that we have.
It's already posted.
It's already posted, yeah. So if you're looking to purchase some tickets, please feel free to help.
And it's not just a Yeti fridge or a Yeti draw.
No, it's not. It's also a Michelob Light fridge.
There it is.
And there's also some Coldstream product to be won as well.
Yes.
Yeah, it's great.
Anybody listen from far away, you guys can enter.
Yep.
And we'll figure out how to get it to you.
Oh, we'll ship it, man.
Yeah. So buy your tickets. We'll get it to you.
And if you're in Ontario, Coldstream's actually moved into Ontario now.
That's right.
Yeah. So hats off to them too. Yes. That's crazy.
They're growing.
Yeah, they are growing.
They are growing. You got a hat on right now.
I do. Yes.
Yeah. Anyway.
Yeah.
Another good episode. Another good week.
Yep.
Not sure.
Scopes with Hill United, by the way.
Oh.
Yeah. At the Florida tournament.
Good. Yeah. I didn't know.
He just shot me a text.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Thanks everybody for listening. Another week. Hobie, have a good week. Oh,
thanks, buddy.
Wait.
What?
I forgot to mention. So this guy had knee surgery yesterday or 2 days ago, and he's here doing a podcast. Like,
yeah, I probably shouldn't be.
How's the knee?
It's pretty good, actually. It's not bad. It's sore. I just had somebody cut me open. So
yeah, I got you penciled in Prodigy Sports opening day roster. So
actually, I'm not allowed to umpire anymore. I was told.
Oh.
Yeah, because I've had too many concussions. I just suffered with one in December and ended up sending me for CAT scans and shit. So
you
can, what, mom? Sing. Keeps ringing that bell.
So you can play.
I can play. Well, I can't take a ball to the face again. Umpiring.
Yeah, but you can play again.
Yeah, maybe. I'm fucking 53.
Let's get that rehab going.
Yeah. There you go. I'd love to play again.
We need a first baseman that can catch a ball.
Lori listens to this.
Lori converted over to third base because Harv doesn't show up.
Oh, I got you.
Anyway.
Okay, man.
Another week. Have a good week, everybody. Like, subscribe, do all that stuff. Classified.
Taking time off from the acting, I gotta relax, I need a new beat. Yo, for stroll, I got a few treats. You been up in the city long? Only 2 weeks. Cool, well, I'm
sorry about the weather. It's been raining all week, I hope it gets a little better. Either way, class, listen, I got an ill vision, but a song I'm working on. You think you got the right rhythm? Man, come on, you know I got some shit that'll break your neck. I used up what I want, but you can take what's left. Don't give me bullshit, dog, you know I blaze the set. You know you got something to say for West. I got an ill concept, hip hop, I will pay the real long distance. What? 1987, I've been rapping in the ciphers in the sessions, and I'm still be getting stressed on the block. You know it's hard to be hip hop, and ain't nobody staying real. Don't pay bills when you showcase skill. Ain't nobody living off and doing windmills. I'm painting train rails, that's real. It's hard to be hip hop. Raps ain't real, cause I don't pack steel, do my tracks appeal. Into the mass appeal, watch a fast they fail. Yeah, I'm hip hop son until my casket sealed. It's hard in the culture when the fans are fickle. To understand my issue, yo man will diss you. 1 minute you're whack and then your jam's official. And then they switch again, throw bottles of cancer hit you. First they loved LL, and then they hated him. And then they loved him again, and they degraded him. So lately, basically, I don't know if I can play to win. Survival of the fittest, let me see what type of shape I'm in. Yo, sure, when I was younger, like 19, I could spend all day writing rhyme schemes. Spitting freestyle and cypher in the streets. But now I got responsibility. Yo, it's hard to be hip hop.
Are you downsizing? Maybe need more room because of additions to the family, or possibly seeking that dream home you've always wanted? Well, Tim Eisner at Royal LePage Atlantic is the guy for you. With a proven track record and multiple awards, Tim goes above and beyond to find out your needs and exactly what you're looking for. So if you're seeking a new home or trying to sell your current one, contact Tim at 902-499-5717 or check him out on Facebook at Tim Eisner. Again, that's 902-499-5717. Trust me, when all is said and done, we'll be saying Tim Eisner strikes again.